free broadcasting system from 1948 through 1953. After the long years of World War II, the nation was hungry for Major League Baseball. Gordon McLendon originated a most innovative concept of recreating ball games for radio broadcasts. Fans clamored to listen to the old Scotchman on the game of the day over his more than 400 radio stations throughout the country. These were done from his basement studios in the old Cliff Towers Hotel in Dallas, Texas. I was privileged to be his assistant. Here's how it worked. A Western Union operator from the press box of a Major League ballpark would transmit the barest essentials of the game being played to his fellow operator, Jack Marshall, who sat to our right in the studio in Dallas. Gordon or I sat on a high stool in front of the mic for the play-by-play. To the left side of us, Nancy Goff, our scorekeeper, with an elaborately designed scorecard, maneuvered the players as the game progressed. Immediately in front of us, through a glass partition, the engineer, Craig Latast, controlled the sound effects. The Western Union teletype might say B10S for ball one outside, or S2C for strike two called. From that, it was up to the fertile imagination and colorful delivery of the old Scotchman to bring the game to life and broadcast the most exciting baseball games of the post-war era. On any afternoon, in small towns and big cities, in barbershops and corner drugstores and in living rooms across the nation, the radio dial was set on LBS waiting to hear, "Hello, everybody everywhere, this is the old Scotchman, Gordon McLendon."
A high inside pitch to Bobby Brown has made it 1-0. One ball and no strikes. Marino ready again. Pitches swung on. There's a foul ball beaten back into the netting. 1-1. Evened up. One ball and one strike. Top half of the eighth inning. Score of the Yankees 9. The Chicago White Sox 7. And batting B this afternoon at Comiskey Park in Chicago, Illinois. Marino Pioretti ready to throw. Right-handed pitches, and Bobby Brown swings, dumps a drive, which is hit in fair territory down the right field line over Dave Philly's head. It is a base hit and extra bases. Brown is steaming for second base and roars in safely standing. Philly through to third base, and Bobby Brown gets a double over Dave Philly's head in right field. Sternweiss at first, Bauer at second, Phillips third, Rizzuto comes up. Snuffy hasn't got himself a smell of a base hit all afternoon. He has been up 5 times and only 4 times officially. He is 0-4 officially, been at the plate 5 times. He walked his last time up in the 7th inning. Up. This signals check, back up and start all over again. He's been at bat 5 times, only 3 times officially. So he is 0-3. Pioretti's pitch is laid down on a bunt, going down toward third base with a squeeze play on. And he up and the throw is to first base. Phillips comes in to score, and Rizzuto beats it out at first base. You can call that a squeeze play because although there were two out, Rizzuto beat it out and squeezed him home from third base on a bunt. Little Scooter beating out a bleeder base hit into the infield, a bunt down toward third base to score Phillips and leave the bases full and bring the Yankee run total to 11. 11 for the Yankees, 7 for the Chicago White Sox.
The old Scotchman back in just a moment. Okay.
This is Wes Wise. You're listening to the actual broadcast of a baseball recreation on the Liberty Broadcasting System with the old Scotchman, Gordon McLendon. The year is 1949.
This is the top of the eighth inning. Thank you, Wesley. This is the old Scotchman, Gordon McLendon. 2-2 between the Boston Red Sox and the Chicago White Sox, and here is the gentleman who has been up in many a similar crucial situation. Luke Appling. There is also activity in the Chicago bullpen in case they're going to have to pinch hit for the Chicago hurler if they ever got down that far. Bob Kuzawa, a southpaw, is now warming up for Chicago. Former Cleveland Indian relief pitcher. Kuzawa, 2-2 ball game. Runners at first and third. Parnell with those shoulders on the line between first and third. Looks in to Luscious Luke. Old aches and pains. Steps up, takes a ball inside. Starting to swing with checking on a beautiful breaking pitch off the hands. Count of one ball, no strikes. score of 2-2. Tight pitcher's duel between Mel Parnell, Randy Gumpert. Activity in the Red Sox bullpen. Tex Houston and Earl Johnson both warming up. Injured liver. You
swung on by Lapling and slapped out into short center field as DiMaggio digging in, and it's in there for a base hit. His Gumpert in to score. And Goldsberry is on his way to third base. His DiMaggio's throw to third. It's closer, and Goldsberry is out at third base. Sliding. He tried a hook slide into third, and Pesky got him on the right kneecap. DiMaggio to Pesky, a perfect throw by the stellar Boston Red Sox center fielder, Dominic DiMaggio. That ends the inning, but not before the Chicago White Sox have broken the existing tie. It's 3-2 now in favor of the White Sox over the Boston Red Sox.
This is Wes Wise. You're listening to the actual broadcast of a baseball recreation on the Liberty Broadcasting System. The year is 1949.
Bobby Fuller ready to pitch into Henry. Goes into a stretch. Long, long, fluid windup. Pitches home to Henry. Henry swings on this one, and there's a drive going deep, deep into right field. Going, going, and gone. A home run into the upper right field stand. And so Tommy Henry comes through again. The lift one high into the upper right field stand this time. Last time it was into the lower stand. And it's his seventh home run of this year. There he goes, making the merry circle, coming in, and Bobby Brown, the golden boy, shakes his hand, gives him a pat on the back. Yogi Berra does the same. He'll be the next batter. So Hendricks hits his second of the afternoon, his seventh of the year. That gives him 3-for-4 in today's game, and he was hitting at a clip of 309 going into today's contest. Coming through again, he's considered old reliable of the Yankee staff now that Joe DiMaggio is out. Maybe permanently, maybe temporarily. Henrik hits a home run. Yogi Berra steps in, calls, strike one on him. Bobby Feller pitches in to Henrik, and there's a guy who can always seem to get to Rapid Robert. Yogi Berra batting now, one strike, no balls on him, 5 feet, 8 inches tall. The Yankees now lead, 6-0. Outside comes another pitch to Berra. We have one away. The bases are, of course, clear. Henrik hit that homer with nobody on base. And once again, Feller into his windup, pitches home to Berra. Berra swings on this one. There's a line drive going over second base into center field for a clean base hit. Larry Doby fields it in center, throws into the infield, and Berra, after taking the turnaround first, comes back, roosts there, and is on the first pillow with a clean line drive single into center field. Dick Wirtz comes on in the top of the second inning. Hoot Evers will follow him. At bat, and then comes Johnny Groth. So we'll have the midsection of the Detroit Tigers batting order, the second, third, that is the fourth, fifth, and sixth batters. Wirtz from York, Pennsylvania, stands in there, big 20 emblazoned upon his back.
Dick has the bat cocked on his left shoulder.
The pitch is swung on, and there is a long drive, which is deep out in right center, going. This one is gone, Goslin into the right center field bleachers at Comiskey Park in Chicago for a home run for Dick Wirtz. A long drive, completely up and over the scoreboard, into the upper deck of the two-tiered bleachers for a home run, and the Detroit Tigers lead by a score of 4-0.
Trying to split a doubleheader with the White Sox, who won the first game of the doubleheader. Mickey Hefner now winding to deliver. The pitch is swung on, and there is another drive, which is in left field this time, and it is also way back there.
It is Don Guslin for a homer, the second in succession. Evers with a long home run into the left field lower deck. That's number one for Hoot. And I believe that this is the first time in my baseball broadcasting experience, the first time I ever remember, that on 2 days running, we had successive home runs.